where we certainly weren't at our best. But I think in the nature of knockout football, you often have to get through periods and get through some struggles as well. And I think it was the other side of the game that I was most proud of, the continued mentality, the collective effort, the winning culture, I think, shone through a little bit there at the end as well to get the job done. So, you know, we're still approaching things the same way now as we would have at the beginning of the season. We're still trying to get better, still trying to learn from mistakes. And yeah, we'll need to make sure that we improve upon a few different details from obviously the win against Vermont to make sure we advance through LMU as well. But good to get through that week. It can often be a tricky one with Thanksgiving as well. There's no students here. There's nothing beyond simply our training environment. So it can be a bit of a funky week in that regard. Just when their only stimulus is the 2 hours they have with us during training time. So hopefully back into what's their normal routine, back in their classes, so on and so forth. And yeah, we can have a great week.
Just a reminder, everybody use the raise hand feature. So Nick, if you want to ask a question.
Dan, good to see you. Look, this team that you're going to face, Loyola Marymount, it seems like they have done a lot despite being outshot in these tournament games. I guess, what are you seeing from them, and why have they advanced despite having fewer quality chances perhaps than some of their opponents?
Well, they're clinical. Obviously, they haven't needed to create too much necessarily for them to take a lead in a game. And then they've been incredibly resolute in terms of their defensive output. You know, we've looked at still going through our process, honestly, in terms of the scouting process, but kind of just going through some things statistically that they've done. If you were to look at, firstly, who they've played this season, they played an incredible schedule. They played, I think, 8 teams inside the top 40, I think, from an RPI perspective, and they're 7-0-1 in those games. So they seem to show up on the big occasion. They seem to do incredibly well against other good teams. And in that stretch of games, I think they've scored 12 and only conceded 3. So they've shown that 1-0 is enough at times. They've shown that they're very capable of defending the penalty area, and then very comfortable if they're not the team in possession, which I would say is a little more rare at this stage in the tournament. Normally you're playing against other teams that like to be the team with the ball, but if you just simply looked at what they've done statistically this season, they've had less possession than their opponent on average throughout the entire season. So it's a slightly different challenge in that regard. I think, you know, we're a team that feel comfortable with the ball, and it appears that they are a team that feels comfortable without it. So yeah, it makes for an interesting chess match for sure.
Cody, go ahead.
Yeah, hi Dan. Just wanted to ask, you know, you've been this far in the tournament before. What's been the biggest difference getting to stay at home for all these games?
I mean, the crowd, right? I think that I've already alluded to it, but there were some struggles last weekend against Vermont. I think the start of the second half was a little sloppy as well. So kind of got to that hour mark and had something resembling a period of play that looked like us, and the crowd getting back into the game, the crowd lifting, and it's that moment really kind of carried us through the next 30 minutes. And then on top of that, obviously, when we get the winner, or what was the eventual winner, with about 9 minutes to go, the enthusiasm, the energy, the lift, you could tell that the crowd was an incredible piece of that, an important piece of that. And then that fight and the energy levels of us were lifted. We were probably more alive in that last 10 minutes than we were maybe any other period in the game. And a lot had to do with the fact that obviously we had a lead to hold on to, but the energy and environment that was created from a packed stand made a huge, huge difference. So they truly were a 12th man, and obviously incredibly excited that we've already sold the game out in the short span of time that we did. Hoping that the student section and the maniacs come out and fill the surplus areas. We're already working towards getting those bleachers put back in, just as we had for the Marshall game earlier in the season. So, yeah, look, I'm hoping that we break another attendance record, go comfortably over 3,000, close to 4,000 will be incredible, and give everyone something to cheer about and a reason to jump in their cars and drive to Louisville next week.
Ryan, go ahead.
So, Coach, kind of on that same note, I guess, and you alluded to the game selling out really quickly. What is the players' reaction to that when they see a game gets sold out in 5-6 hours, and then how can that also fuel them? You kind of mentioned this too, with the crowd being there and them being that 12th man, so to speak. How does that fuel them? And can you see that from them during the game?
Yeah, look, I mean, like I said, look, we're undefeated at home this season. If you want to go break it down into even further details, you look at obviously Marshall, Louisville, Vermont, where we have sold all three of those games out with 3-0, right? So the trend is a real positive one. For me, that has to be more than just coincidence. There has to be a correlation there. And really, as I alluded to, there were moments where we weren't quite at our best in honestly both the last two games, but there was a clear period for me where we definitely could have been better against Vermont. And the manner in which the crowd provided support and gave encouragement in those moments. And then obviously, as I said, late on when you're defending a lead and protecting something, protecting the win, the encouragement and support that you could hear from the crowd, it was incredibly uplifting, not just honestly for the bench and for the staff. It had to feel that way for the players as well. So it makes a huge, huge difference. And yeah, hoping for an incredible environment and atmosphere again on Saturday.
Kevin, go ahead.
Coach, is it important in the postseason when things tend to get a little more conservative and tighter, you know, more stressful, that your team still plays free-flowing, you know, attacking, aggressive soccer? I mean, that's been the hallmark of your programs. I would think as you advance and get further, you guys still have to be yourselves. You can't be careful trying to avoid a mistake.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think the type of team that we've evolved into this season, and to your point as well, right, our identity has been with the intent of being dynamic, quick in transition moments, want the ball back as quickly as possible, territorially to try and play the game in advanced areas. Fear and conservatism does us no favours right now. We have to feel like we go for it. And to some extent, if we're going to go out, we go out on our terms, right? We go out doing it the way that we did it. There would be far more regret if we were to not advance, playing in a style that didn't suit us or playing in a style that hadn't won us 16 games already this season. So by no means do we intend to change. I've obviously talked a little bit about how we adapt stylistically and certain principles to fit the context. Of course, being with the lead with 8 minutes to go does change things a little bit at that point. But for the most part, we will have the intention of trying to be the team of the ball, trying to get the ball back as quickly as possible and playing the game in the attacking half. And that's really been a hallmark of probably any team I've coached and will certainly be the way we try to set things up against LMU. And I'm sure it's not anything groundbreaking or anything that's going to surprise anyone at LMU by me saying this four days out before the game.
John, you like that?
Hey, curious, Coach. Do you want it cold and uncomfortable, or dry, warm, and fast on Saturday?
maybe somewhere not quite this cold, because you know, we're looking at alternative options for where we're going to train tomorrow. I didn't see snow in the forecast this week. That's for sure. So, no, look, I don't know that matters all that much at this stage. I think the conditions are more relating to where we're playing, right? Like our grass field, at the size and dimensions of our field, the atmosphere that will be created from that perspective. If it's cold for them, it'll be cold for us as well. I was freezing against Vermont in the second half. So on a selfish note, I don't mind if it's 58 and sunny. But no, look, that aspect of what either team is going to have to deal with is a very, very minimal impact on probably the outcome of the game.
Gotcha.
Back to you, Cody.
Yeah, Dan, I was thinking a similar thing. Just, you know, I'm sure throughout the year you prepared for the possibility of rain, but given this morning, how do you, you know, in a week prepare the guys that there might be snow on Saturday?
Yeah, well, I mean, we'll see. We'll have to adapt, right? I would argue, given the statistics of what we've looked into with LMU, if the conditions make it more difficult for us to possess and us to be the team with the ball, then you might argue that could favour a team that's more comfortable without the ball, such as LMU. So, again, going back to that context of how we play, that was relevant last spring. We had to go to some difficult places quite often when you play in the spring season. You're not necessarily playing on the quality of field that you have the luxury of getting in the fall semester when the fields have had the summer to be prepared. So we had to play in some difficult conditions in the spring season in that regard. And if that's the outcome, or that's the what we have to deal with, the reality is my expectations are that we're going to have to break down an incredibly compact, very well organized, good defensive side that can be very, very clinical with perhaps the limited chances that they may find themselves getting. I hope they're limited, certainly. We'll still have to be very vigilant. And whether or not that's on a perfect surface or whether it's cold, wet, snowing, either way, the number of bodies that they're prepared to put in front of the ball and the quality desire they show to defend the penalty area, that's going to be difficult under any circumstances.
Nick, back to you.
Dan, I didn't know Englishman got cold.
This Englishman's been here a while now.
So at the beginning of the year, when we talked about your team, Dan, you kind of mentioned that you thought you'd have the offense to win games, but the defense with so many new parts, you just didn't know what you didn't know, right? You've got four total transfers in your back five, including Jackson from 2 years ago. Freddie's the only one you recruited, I guess, naturally, right? How has that unit come together in the manner in which it has to be so successful this season?
Yeah, you're right. I say this all the time. Recruiting is to some extent is educated guessing. It really is. There's never a sure thing. I didn't recruit Marcus, for example, and expect him to score 12 goals his sophomore year. Those things can happen organically, and there's some added bonuses, obviously, when they exceed expectations. You obviously hope and believe in their potential, but they still have to go through a process to reach it as well. So to your point with the transfers and that aspect of things, I would say perhaps there's a little more of an advantage because you have some college soccer experience and some context there to base your decision on. But until they're in our environment, right, until they're used to being coached by me and involved and immersed in our culture and understand all of that, a lot of things have to fall into place before you're going to get the best of certain players. With those guys that we have brought in, what I didn't know and what I didn't account for is just how well we have defended the penalty area at times. So for all three of them, obviously, Jackson's been incredible as well. But for Braden, for Carlos and for Max in particular, I don't know that we recruited them. Maybe Braden, we saw some of it with his time at Liberty, but I don't know that we had brought them in fully appreciating just how prepared they are to put their body on the line, to block shots, to head things, the pride that they take in their defensive responsibilities when it really, really comes down to that final shot, or that close proximity to the goal. They've been unbelievable this season, probably some of the best I've ever worked with in the college game. So that's been a pleasant surprise, obviously, because yeah, there's so many attributes and so many different qualities that we look for in our centre backs and our defenders. Of course, you want those, but I don't know that they were as glaringly obvious as they've become as a result of what we've seen from them this season. So, yeah, long may it continue. That would be the one area where, to complement LMU, they look like they have that desire, that will, that mindset in their defensive unit and centre backs as well. So, they're not going to make it easy for us in that regard either.
Ryan, back to you.
So, Dan, obviously, the second time in the last 3 years you guys get to this stage of the NCAA tournament. What can you guys take from that last trip to the quarterfinals and learn from it, take it to this one? Or has everything changed so much with, you know, different opponent, new team for you guys, new venue, obviously, or different venue? Is it too different, or are there things that do kind of carry over to this one?
I mean, the experience and knowing that, you know, I think back to the Georgetown game and with incredible pride for the way that we played the game, right? We went there and we played within our identity. We went for it. It was two very, very good teams at the time in a really, really close contest, and we came out the wrong side of a penalty shootout. There was no element of that game where I felt like we fell short of effort, application, intent. From that perspective, I want to make sure that obviously we can say the same for the remainder of the season. I think what's changed, and I think where we've tried to be a little more strategic, is to, you know, when I spoke to the group on Monday, obviously following the result and a day off on Sunday, the challenge I presented to the players is that, you know, 2 weeks today, speaking from last Monday, 2 weeks today, someone's playing for a national championship, right? And do we have the mental fortitude, the focus, the mental endurance, whatever you want to call it, but do we have the capacity to be great for 2 weeks? Can we have the mindset there's 14 days left in the season, that we'll play three games, we would train nine times, and what would it take for you individually and us collectively as a team to be great for 2 weeks, two measly weeks, should I say? How hard would that be for us? And what does it need to look like? And we went back to a lot of things that we have done and preached this season regarding consistency, the way that we approach training, the way that we approach scouts, the expectations that they set for themselves at the start of the season, when it comes to the fundamentals of having a professional environment and a winning mentality within our environment. And there was a ton of eye contact, a ton of head nodding. And I think everyone is bought into the idea that, yeah, if we have to apply ourselves the right way to every day for just 2 weeks to finish this out and give ourselves the potential to win a national championship, then I think they feel like they're very, very capable of that. Where we have to be careful, and what was also reminded of them, is, of course, that means we can't overlook anyone. But the one thing I wanted to try to change the mindset of was that the Elite Eight was incredible and was a milestone for this program, right? Every win, really, since Vermont, I would argue, is a new accolade for this team, another new milestone for this team. It was the 16 win mark, right? It's if we make a Final Four, it's something that the program's never done. If we make a national championship, it's something the program's never done. And I wanted to get beyond just this potential pitfall of, okay, the accomplishment is making the Final Four. The accomplishment is winning the whole thing at this point, right? And whilst we won't overlook anyone, and you know, you can't win it all if you don't win on Saturday, I wanted the intent and the mindset and the approach of the players to be that there's 2 weeks left of the season, and you've got to really, really double down on what it is we've done well and have an incredible level of focus on what we do for just 2 weeks.
John, go ahead.
I have one more here, and it's kind of on the weather, and it's a little bit above what you're doing now. You know, you think about the way your sport's set up, your most important games now are in November. And I'm looking here, I guess Notre Dame and Indiana are going to encounter maybe the same thing you guys are. And then next week you're at Louisville, where weather could be also an issue. Do you like how it's set up? I mean, the way you play soccer in September and October can be different now if weather's an issue.
Yeah, that's a bigger picture philosophy question, probably, with conversations that have happened on a broader level, on a national level, regarding the potential of a year-round season and schedule for men's soccer. There was a substantial push for that, and it did go to a vote, I think narrowly missing out at the time. But that is one of the arguments, right? If you're asking me if I want to play a Final Four in December versus in May, well, I'm not that picky. I just want to play in a Final Four. Right. But if I had the luxury of choosing, of course, the quality of conditions, the weather, what that does to attract fans and get the best attendance that we can at a neutral site in particular, I think it obviously helps if it can be later in the year. Mm. But you know, that's the nature of the way the college athletics is set up right now. There's very few sports that have the luxury of playing through both semesters, and we're a full sport, so it's probably not something I spend too much time thinking about unless it really comes to the stage, if you like. There are, of course, other challenges if you start to play in the spring of just how the beginning of the spring would look like as well. So pick your poison, right? Do you want it to be cold at the start of the year? Do you want it to be cold at the end of the year? So that's kind of where we find ourselves right now.
But what about playing style? I mean, does that impact the way you play? Because you obviously it could be different in November, December than it is. I mean, I'm looking here at Stanford, Clemson, probably looking at ideal conditions. North Carolina, Oregon State, probably looking in ideal conditions. Down on your bracket, it could be completely different.
Yeah. I mean, we watched, I kept an eye on Notre Dame against Western Michigan, and the field was covered in snow. They were using the orange illuminated ball. Right. It made it very, very difficult. And again, credit to Notre Dame, because I think they went down to 10 men after about 15 minutes. Did the conditions help with one less player because Western Michigan didn't have the capacity to maybe move the ball as effectively because the field was covered in snow? You could make that argument. Now, that's not Notre Dame's fault. That's not Western Michigan's fault. Just circumstantial. So, look, of course, the way that we try to play, regardless of what our opponent does, the way that we try to play, of course, we want the best conditions possible. I had already reached out to our grounds crew to coordinate with them, whatever it was we could do. The field has held up incredibly well, and look, we're guaranteed that this is the last home game of the season. Let's go out with a bang. Let's go out and play a brand of football on the best field that we possibly can. And I know they're working hard this week to make that the case. They may have some other factors and variables to deal with, such as today. But look, if that means we have to adapt, it's no different to what I alluded to before. I think that is probably the biggest difference from a year ago, is I think we are a little bit more capable of adjusting and adapting to the context of what the environment requires. And if it's snow and difficult conditions, then that will change things slightly. But not the intent of us being the more dominant team with the ball and territorially where the game is played.
Yeah. Don't want to make you paranoid.
No problem. I appreciate it. There's no weatherman on staff, so this is helpful.
Cody?
Yeah, Dan, so you talked about how much the home crowd helps, but I'm wondering how much does, when you're at home, you don't have to pack a bag, you don't have to get on the bus, get on the plane, stay in a hotel. How much does that stuff help the guys?
Yeah, I think it does as well. I think, the comfortability of routine and then how you associate that, right? So obviously, as I mentioned before, the home record has been incredible this year. So the routines that they have become accustomed to at this point in the season leading into home games has worked in the past, right? So there's a level of familiarity, comfortability with us being here. Sometimes it's nice to get on the road, honestly. Sometimes it's quite nice to be in a hotel and be away from other potential distractions and pitfalls. With there not being a football game and again, it being a little bit cooler temperatures, we're not expecting there to be too many distractions this weekend or anything else really going on that's going to affect them in that regard. So yeah, good night's rest in their own room for the remainder of the week. And again, that creature of habit aspect of what we do, we know where we eat and when we eat and who's providing the food. We have a routine of things nutritionally for them when we play at home. So all of those familiarities will be, in play again here on the weekend.
If anybody else has any more questions, feel free to jump in. Otherwise, thank you, everybody, and we'll see you on Saturday.